educative lecture, and then I'll just give the time now for questions. We have some questions already under the group chat. I don't know if they want to talk or we should just read up from the group chat. Idris, would you like to talk? Hi, Idris.
Hello, please just read from the group chat.
Oh, okay. Okay, that's fine. So Idris Ola is one of our mentors and mentees in the program. He asks, what is the proportion of greenhouse gases produced by agricultural practices compared to industrial activities?
Right, it's about a quarter. Agricultural practices are about a quarter. Let me share my screen again and get back to that slide. Hold on 1 second.
So is it more than industrial and automobile activities?
Can you see this? Can you see this slide?
Yes.
Okay, so the global greenhouse gas emissions by gas, it's mostly carbon dioxide, but if you look at it by economic sector, agriculture and forestry and land use, the methane, the nitrous oxide, account for about almost a quarter, about 24% of the global greenhouse gas emissions. So industry is 21%, electricity is 25%, transportation is about 14%, and then there are others as well.
Okay. So the other question is, if we are concerned about negative effects of climate change on agriculture and food security, why is the focus of climate change discussion still largely on agricultural practices promoting climate change? If we stop these practices, how do we survive? So I just want to add to that because it's also a burning question for me, because in developing countries, African countries, it's a very integral part of our economy.
Absolutely.
And of our existence. So how do we have to create that balance?
Yes, so I think it's important to know this is a very useful website, the FAO website, GLEAM, Global Livestock Environmental Assessment Model. And if you look at livestock production by region, the big producers are Latin America, North America, Asia. The big livestock emissions by region, hold on, let me see if I can find that. Yeah, here's livestock emission by region. So Africa is actually one of the smaller sources of emissions according to the FAO. The big producers are Latin America, North America, South Asia, and Asia. So I don't think really Africa at this point, I mean, you want to have practices that are as energy sustainable as possible, but in terms of the global contribution, you are producing the least. So you have actually the moral authority to tell others that they've got to get their act together and have the political will to implement some of these technologies. I mean, here in the US, well, first of all, we have a government now that's just denying climate change because they're owned by the oil industry. And the oil industry has really been, I mean, they've known about these problems for decades and they're doing nothing about it because all they care about is their profits. So, I mean, they've purged all discussion of it in this country while we are a major emitter. So without our leadership, you know, our environmental regulations have been reversed. It's been an absolute disaster for us. So getting the political will at this time is going to be very hard because we just don't have the leadership. We're being attacked. And of course, as you can imagine, Russia is a major beneficiary of oil. I mean, that's their number one export. So they don't have any incentive to do anything about it. And they're not going to be as hard hit by climate change as much as the other countries, as you recall, in that World Bank model. So some countries are going to be the beneficiaries, others are going to be the losers. And it's going to be very hard to get the political will necessary. I mean, the only reason we're, you know, addressing, you know, with this pandemic is showing us how much society impacts on the environment, because the environment's actually quite happy with all of us hiding in our homes. You know, the skies are cleaner, the wildlife are roaming more, they're quite happy. How we can continue that without, you know, completely disrupting our economies is a very tall order. I don't really have an answer for that. Again, it requires groundswell grassroots support, which we had been getting until this pandemic started, and then that just kind of took over the focus rather than climate change. But climate change is really still the most important issue facing us in the 21st century.
Okay, so Dr. Shehu Shamsuddin has a question. Mm-hmm. So I'll let him ask his question. Dr. Shehu?
Yeah, so good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Laura.
Yeah.
In fact, yeah, it's a pleasure for us having you here on this platform as one of the champions of leading the conversation around One Health globally. It's really a big honor to have you. So I'm a bit curious, seeing that most of the people who have been driving conversation about One Health, usually from the veterinary side, I'll more personal question. How did you stumble on One Health? What actually attracted your interest in One Health, being that you are from the human medical side? That is one. Then secondly, talking about climate change, vis-a-vis food security, livestock production, I don't know, what's your opinion on the innovations that are upcoming now in some countries, innovations such as plant-based meat production, mm-hmm. or the so-called laboratory meat. Do you think it's a suitable alternative? Do you think it's going to help us reduce the impact or the contribution of livestock, the mainstream livestock production to climate change? Yeah, so.
Right. No, thank you for your questions. I'll answer the second one first. actually, I have an article that I'm happy to share with you in Issues of Science and Technology about the whole meat issue. And there are people who say, oh, you know, these plant-based meat alternatives are the answer, or laboratory clean meat are the answer. I mean, right now they are an option for people who can afford them because they are not cheap. The laboratory meat is still pretty much in research and development, and it's not ready for widespread use, and it will be expensive. So it's not going to be an answer to feed the world, nor will these plant-based alternatives, unless they can really ramp it up. I don't see them as being a major substitution. Now, you know, one of the most interesting aspects of this, again, looking at India, religion is a major driver of human behavior, and they have the most vegetarians, percentage of vegetarians in their country in the world, because Hinduism promotes vegetarianism. So, you know, the other religions are more meat-based. So, I mean, one option is to get these religions to become more vegetarian or promote that is one way to look at it. Or one way to perhaps address it, or looking at alternatives like insects, which again aren't that palatable for many of us in Western countries. But we need to find a way to satisfy the protein needs, the micronutrient needs, in a satisfying and culturally appropriate way for much of the public. Some of these animals are less productive of greenhouse gases than, say, you know, the ruminants. So, you know, eating more of them might be an answer. But again, raising thousands of these animals together, you know, creates a huge amount of manure and nitrous oxide. So, you know, we have to recognize that many of these solutions still come with their own environmental challenges. So, you know, we still, I think, need some good research and development into what's going to be an alternative protein source that's going to satisfy the meat needs of so many people, whether, and you know, whether we alter demand by religion or some other strategy, you know, that's something that's going to have to develop as time goes on and as our resources diminish. In terms of how I got interested in this, I've always been interested in animal health. And in fact, growing up, I wanted to be a veterinarian, but getting into veterinary medical school is a lot harder than medical school. and you only learn one species rather than a whole bunch of them. So it seemed like medical school was going to be easier to get into. My interest never waned. I was always more interested in preventing disease than treating it. I was always interested in public health. And when I moved to New Jersey, just as I was about to start my master's in public policy program here at Princeton, that was the year of 9/11 and anthrax. That was 2001. And that changed the trajectory of my career. I decided to go into biodefense policy research. So I came to it from the biodefense, bioterrorism angle. My focus has always been more on the biological side of things rather than, say, the comparative medicine side of things. So that's kind of how I got into it. It wasn't through any foresight. It was purely serendipity and chance, really, that got me into it. And to be honest, going through all my medical training, the term zoonotic disease never once was ever uttered. It was just not even recognized. So it wasn't until I was doing my policy research and was reading some of the veterinary medical literature where I read about this overlap, the overlap between emerging diseases and bioterrorism, and the fact that most of them are zoonotic, diseases of animals that affect people. And yet I discovered in my research that the physicians and the veterinarians never talked to each other, much less collaborated, nor did the health departments or the agriculture departments. You know, we had the West Nile virus outbreak in New York City in 1999, and the person who figured it out was the chief veterinary pathologist at the Bronx Zoo, and nobody listened to her because she was a veterinarian. And to me, that was a huge problem. That was a real wake-up call, and realized the importance of veterinary medicine, animal health, in all of this that we're talking about, but they are generally ignored. We're very speciistic in terms of our perspectives, particularly in medicine and public health, just focusing on the humans. But by doing that, we're missing the entire picture, the major part of the picture of the animals in the environment, because we live in an environment and we're interacting with animals, whether live animals or by animal products, eating it. And yet, you know, we're not including that in our discussion. So you know, that was a real kind of wake-up call for me. And, you know, the veterinarians understand this, but trying to get this word out to public health professionals and to the medical community has been much easier said than done. They are very reductionistic in their approach to health and disease. They've, you know, focused on organ systems. They're not talking about, you know, the causation, the root cause of disease. They're just treating it. And to me, that's a big problem.
Thank you. I have another question here from Onyeye. She's asking, are there no side effects in using insects as feed, as stated in the last slide, considering the nutritional needs and insect populations?
Right.
So I also want to add to that question, in the sense that what's the basis of proposing insects as a source of protein? Like you said, in the Western countries, it's not a viable option. Right. Sincerely, in Africa, at least I can speak for Nigeria, that would not even be an option in Nigeria. So what's the basis for proposing insects?
Right. Well, the Food and Agriculture Organization actually has a big website on this. And let me just say FAO and insects as food. They actually are, they have a large case on arguing of insects for food. So this came from the FAO. And when I teach my One Health class here at Princeton, a lot of the students come to the conclusion that insects are the answer. So it, you know, it wasn't something that just popped into my head. It was just looking at all possible alternatives. But again, you know, culturally, it's a huge issue. But I have my students try to figure out what food source would they recommend if they were to live on a Mars colony. And many of them recommend that, you know, that everybody eat crickets. So crickets are very high in protein and provide a lot of nutrients. But again, you know, you have to get over your revulsion to eat them. So
we do here too.
The hypothesis, it's certainly not, you know, the end all and be all of the solution here. It's just, you know, something to consider. And you're right. You know, a lot of the insect populations are diminishing because of widespread pesticide use and environmental destruction. So, you know, it depends on the insect. I mean, obviously we need our pollinators to be healthy because they're so important for our fruits and vegetables. So, I mean, you know, again, it's all tied together. What we do to the environment, if we're killing the environment, we're ultimately hurting ourselves.
Okay. So we'll take like 2-3 more questions and then we'll close. Andrew Oroke asks, some school of thought believe that climate change has been politicized. And it further believes that climate change, even though it's real, but it's occurring at a slower pace than scientists have proposed. Please, what is your view on this?
Well, it has moved slowly for the past 30 some odd years because the oceans have been absorbing all of the carbon dioxide. The oceans have been a sink. But in the process of doing that, they've become more and more acidic. And now we are seeing widespread die-offs of coral reefs, like the Great Barrier Reef in Australia. A large fraction of it has bleached and died. So we are now starting to see the effects of absorbing all of this carbon dioxide into the oceans. And we are now starting to see more effects on land. You know, we had 3 major hurricanes last hurricane season in the Caribbean. We're getting more severe storms. We're getting very weird weather here in North America. We've had snow in periods where there's not supposed to be snow. We've had wildfires just out of control, widespread wildfires in Australia, if you recall. So we're starting to see the impact. And then of course in Africa, you're starting to see some of the impacts as well. So, I mean, the Earth was able to absorb all of this for only so long. And now we're reaching kind of the saturation point where the effects are now going to become more and more obvious. The problem is you put up these greenhouse gases and there's about a 30-year time lag between what you put into the atmosphere and what you observe. So what we're experiencing now was the greenhouse gases that were put up 30 years ago because, again, the oceans were absorbing a lot of it. So now, you know, what we put up is going to be felt 30 years from now, and it's just kind of ongoing and building on itself, becoming worse and worse. And we're not very good at foresight and preparation. We're usually more of a reactive species, which is why responding to this has been so difficult. But, you know, I think there's enough red flags being raised if we want to try and preserve civilization for our kids and future generations, we really need to act on it as soon as possible.
All right. So I saw some information on the chat box, which I can attest to, that some insects are actually deadly cases. Well, yeah, in Nigeria, termites, crickets, I can attest to that because I know that growing up, we used to have this flying termites around our bulb, and then we used to catch them and put them in water before frying them. So yeah, we did have that, but I'm not sure that's really much a thing now that it's 2020. I've not heard of such in a very long time. But I think I'll also do my research, at least my online research on this, and try to find more about this because it's very interesting. Professor Fashino has a question, so I'll give him that opportunity. Sir?
I have a question too.
Okay. Yes. I saw the hands raised.
Yes, I raised my hand.
Okay. Okay, but after him, ma.
Okay. Oh, thank you, Laura, for a very interesting presentation. And what I want to say is just a little contribution as well as a question. One, as to the use of insects, it's actually being promoted and is gaining momentum. Indeed, mm-hmm. I can tell you recently, you are aware that there is a locust outbreak in part of the world, East Africa and some part of,
part of
Pakistan and some other part of the world. Now, what happened was that in a country like Kenya, they actually converted the locust into something that can be fed. For example, now there is an industrialist who began to pay 250 Kenyan shillings per kilogram of locusts that are trapped by citizens. So people mm-hmm. went out and began to trap these locusts. It was collecting them and was making them into protein-rich diet for animal. Mm-hmm. And then begin to convert them for animal feed. And so this become widespread within Kenya. And so it can be one of the alternative to utilizing insects.
That's right.
And I know I worked in northern part of Nigeria for about 10 years. And I know that they eat some type of insects in northern Nigeria. I can attest to that. So one of the major challenges with One Health with regards to either food security, climate change, and all these other issues is the fact that we still have this reductionist theory. A lot of us carry reductionist mentality. For example, if you call an average of we that are on this forum now discussing this issue about the concept of One Health, we only talk in terms of public health and veterinary health, that's animal health, public health. We will largely ignore environmental health. We will largely ignore climate change. We will largely ignore even sociology, the social science aspect, the policy aspect of the thing. For example, if you look at the issue of COVID that is affecting the world now, initially we see it as a public health challenge. Everybody left it to the public health physician. Unfortunately, most of the public health physicians cannot communicate social science. They could not communicate to the policymakers. They could not communicate to the politicians. So the politician sees it as a challenge to them because politicians now need to take political and economic decision instead of public health decision. And that was why when it started in China, everybody sees it as China's problem. It moved to Iran. Everybody sees it as Iran's problem. Moved to Italy. Everybody sees it as Italy problem until it covers everywhere in the world now. All of us are challenged and everybody is involved. So we need to begin to change our concept and mentality about what One Health is all about. I participated in an online discussion with regards to One Health in Germany just about 2 days back. And this issue began to come up. And one of the hottest debates was what is actually the definition of One Health? Because now the environmentalist sees it differently, the social scientist sees it differently, policymakers. So we need to begin to be all inclusive in our mentality. We are actually currently, we are developing a paper on One Health, and we try to use cluster analysis to cluster the different stakeholders in One Health. You'll be amazed at how diverse people's opinion are with regards to what One Health is. This is my contribution. Over.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yes, I mean, one of the great challenges is trying to exactly define it. I mean, for me, I use it as a philosophy, as a concept, and how to approach some of these issues. For others, it has to be much more defined, particularly at the governmental level. Well, you know, how much is it going to cost? And how are we going to implement it? And at least from the medical perspective, I mean, they look at it in a very defined way. They're mostly approaching it from the comparative medicine perspective, looking at, so I'm working with some obstetric gynecologists in Rutgers University, and they're approaching it as learning from the reproductive practices in veterinary medicine, perhaps applying some of that to human medicine and back and forth. A lot of these disease processes are shared, so we can learn from each other. So for example, in terms of COVID, we're discovering that veterinarians were doing research on vitamin D metabolism in animals and their response to these coronaviruses. Well, now it's just starting to be examined in the medical field, looking at the role of vitamin D deficiency and the severity of COVID symptoms. There seems to be a very strong relationship. So they're applying it in a very specific way, looking at therapeutics. I look at it from a broad societal perspective, looking at food security, climate change, and One Health. I mean, that's my, in a microbial perspective, that's how I come to it, but I think everybody kind of applies it. I mean, and that's the beauty of it. Everybody applies it in the way that's most useful for them. So, I mean, you know, I don't think you really need exactly one all-encompassing definition, but it's how you apply it, you know, to improve the outcomes of our health and well-being, and the health and well-being of the other species on this planet. I mean, ultimately, that's what we're all trying to get at. So yes, I agree with you. There's been a challenge in just getting, you know, how to agree on it, but we're all coming to this with our own perspectives. And I think applying it from our perspective is what makes it so useful and powerful. Let's see, was there another part of your question that I didn't address?
I think you've addressed most of it though.
Okay.
Yeah. And thank you so much, Professor Fashino. That was a very, very
strong
statement, and I totally agree with him. Yes.
I appreciate that. I mean, this isn't an easy thing to do. I mean, in terms of country by country, I mean, we're all just focused on our little country, but really we're citizens of this planet. And trying to overcome our, you know, our parochial perspectives to look at, you know, what's good for us as a species is not something that we're very good at doing, I think, in general, as a species, unless there is a external common threat to all of us. You know, if there were like aliens coming from another planet, then we would have to all like work together to try and get rid of them. I mean, you can kind of think of this virus as kind of a, you know, global threat, but we're not doing it collaboratively. I mean, we have a president who prefers to place blame on others rather than own up to all the faults that he's been, you know, mistakes and problems that he's been creating. You know, that's, you know, leadership, political leadership is so important. Who's in charge? And, you know, I can't tell you how much that can either help or hurt your effort in addressing these things.
Okay, so let's have Madam Foluke Areola ask
Thank you very much. Lauren, thank you very much for your presentation. Very insightful, very interesting. And I don't know how you were able to put everything together, one flowing into another, and still carry all of us along all through. Thank you so much for your effort. I'm aware that of recent, many people are trying to use black soldier fly to make fish feed food. And mm-hmm. I have been very concerned about human health and also about certification and acceptance of the product on the international market. You've sort of answered most of it because some people have mentioned a lot about the use of insects for food. And I know that in Nigeria, many people eat termites, grasshoppers, crickets, and they're even sold in the open market. But using them for fish feed, because I knew there was a time when maggots was introduced and FAO frowned at it because of people's attitude and perceptions to eating the products that has been fed with maggots. But now that people are looking for alternatives to fish meal, and with the COVID, not many exports, at least to Nigeria, we are not getting the amount of fish meal that we need to meet the demand of the aquaculture sector. And people are now doing trainings on black soldier ants to use them to make as an alternative protein source to fish feed. What do you think about it? And I'm thinking of certification of our products to the EU, the American market, and other international markets, because we have things we're dealing with already, and I don't want this to become an addition to placing a restriction on our products getting in on the international market. That's my number one. And then I want to let you know that for decades now, we've had glass houses in Nigeria, in Kenya, in many countries in Nigeria. We do use them, just for the record. And lastly, I have concern about the open grazing system that we have in Nigeria, where we have our animals just roaming about, and we will have issues of monkeys going about in residential places, entering homes. And when you are speaking about their droppings and the effect, it really touched me, and I'm worried, because if we have the open grazing system here, where our cattle roam about and people move them from cities to cities, and every attempt to for us to have a grazing reserve has been opposed because of political reasons and so many other reasons. So I just want you to comment on this and give us probably suggestions as to how to go forward in handling all these things. Thank you so much for your presentation.
Thank you. Well, those are really challenging questions that you asked, you know, and I'm not really familiar with the conditions in your country. You know, one of the challenges with trying to develop solutions is you don't want to create a problem worse. You know, in trying to address one problem, you don't want to create a new one. And so when you're trying to develop alternative feeds, like for fish, you want to make sure that it's ecologically sustainable, that it's not going to introduce a new problem. And usually that happens after the fact, after you've already discovered the problem. But I mean, you want to make sure that, you know, your production of the fish meal is economical. It does not pose large environmental problems, large production of waste. And you want to make sure that you're not introducing new microbes, new diseases into it. So those are, you know, things that you have to investigate, in a kind of a pilot program, if you will, before applying it on a wide scale basis. I mean, one of the nice things about raising insects is they don't require all that much room, and they don't produce as much waste, and they certainly don't produce the greenhouse gases that all the other animals, the mammals, are producing. So it might be viable. Again, it's not an area that I've looked into in terms of feed for animals. So, but that has been touted by the FAO as one solution, by other groups as well. Yes, in terms of like the monkeys and other wildlife and domesticated animals that are living around homes, they're defecating in homes, they're defecating outside homes, kids are playing in those areas, and it might inadvertently touch it. When we talk about sanitation and hygiene, we're generally not talking about animal droppings, we're talking about human waste. And that has to be a large paradigm shift then, if we want to reduce the microbial burden that people have in their environment to reduce their risk of getting illness, because these animal droppings do have a lot of the microbes and parasites that are some of the top microbial causes of diarrheal mm-hmm. diseases in people. Mm-hmm. So we need a sanitation system, not only for human fecal waste, but for animal as well. And that has to be a large educational program for people to recognize that, because it contributes to foodborne, waterborne, and direct right. illness. Your third question, I'm trying to remember what that third question was. Can you remind me?
I spoke about the black fly, and yeah. then that we have greenhouses in Africa.
Yeah. Yes, thank you for that. I wasn't aware of that. I mean, I knew they're common in the north. I wasn't sure how common they were in Africa, because I imagine the climate is generally, you know, you've got the rainy season and the dry season, but I don't think you get quite the extent of, you know, cold temperatures that we get here, where we just can't really grow anything in the winter when you've got snow and ice. But I would imagine if you've got, you know, heavy rains, then the crops aren't going to be able to tolerate that. So that's a situation where greenhouses would be beneficial.
Yes, it's not that they are very common like that, but we do have them, and they're used for specific crops. Probably, I know in Kenya, that is the main thing that is used for their flowers for export. And in Nigeria, we have them being used to grow some vegetables. We are in Lagos State, for instance, there's a young girl who that is all she does, and many others. I know a few who practice it in Nigeria. And we have the government quarantine service to have large greenhouses where we grow things things that are imported or things that are going out, so that we're sure we can see what is in them before we allow them to go out. But some people do use them specifically because they want to achieve some standards before they move their products out. And there's some food outlets that demand that, even in Nigeria, not just for export alone. Some supermarkets, we want you to grow your things so that they are sure that what you are putting on this on the market is safe for human consumption, and you don't have issues of contamination like you do have in cabbages that are grown in open farms where people defecate, and the issue of pylori. There had been issue of pylori from eating fresh fruits that we are trying to avoid, and so we have people who are investing in having greenhouses too, but then they place a premium on their products for doing that.
Yeah, I mean, if you're going to grow your crops in a greenhouse, you're going to charge a lot more.
Yes.
You're going to be able to assure biosecurity for those yes. crops. You're going to be able to reduce the risk of fecal contamination. Absolutely.
Okay, thank you so much. I'm actually learning so much here. So we'll take one last question from Dr. Shehu. He said, I noticed you did some studies on policy. What do you think of the role of knowledge on policy and advocacy in achieving One Health? That'll be our last question.
Okay, thanks. Well, part of the challenge with One Health, with public health, you know, you think that many of these issues, the decisions, the policy decisions that are made to address them, you think that they are made by the best available science. And what we are discovering, and what I discovered when I was in government, particularly state government here in New Jersey, was that many of the decisions are made by politics and by financial, contributions to the politicians rather than the best science. In other words, certain levels of corruption. And that is really where we need to make sure that, you know, policies are made on the best science and not on politics. And that's a tall order. I mean, certainly in this country, we've reduced our trust, the role of scientists in government and outside of government. It's been really devastating for those of us in the policy world to get, you know, the federal government to listen to science and, you know, rational thinking when you're dealing with somebody with a political leader who doesn't believe in science, who downplays science, and who muzzles the scientists. So absolutely, it requires political leadership that wants to do the right thing for the people in their country, whose top priority is the health and well-being of the people to whom they've, you know, who've entrusted in them the political power to make these policy decisions. And when they are only making decisions for their own benefit, everybody suffers, as we are discovering here in the United States. And it's been quite devastating, quite disillusioning to see this happen on such a large, devastating scale where thousands are losing their lives because of the poor policy decisions that are being made. So it's up to us, for those of us who live in a democracy or who think they live in a democracy, to make sure that you elect political leaders who are honest, who are transparent, and who, you know, want to do the right thing and who are not in it to just line their own pockets for their own benefit. And that's a tall order for all of us, because there appears to be a rise of corruption, not only in our country, in the US, but in other countries as well, where the will of the people is being subverted. And so getting policies made by the best science requires then a demand from the public that, you know, they're not going to tolerate this kind of corruption again, that we want action and we want it ASAP. Now, that's a tall order for all of us as citizens of our country, as citizens of the world. We need to rise up together and to make sure that we put in place leaders that will do the right thing.
Yes. Thank you so much, Dr. Laura Khan, for the presentation. And thank you for, thank you audience for being a very wonderful and engaging audience in this webinar. So I'll just, I don't know if I can give like a complete recap, but I just want to say that I love the fact that the connection